thank you so much for inviting me. You know, it's wonderful to be around with this, and I'll tell you why in a second. But first, let me tell you the kinds of conversations I have. You know, I can move to that, like, people tell me, they say, you know, you've had, oh my God, you've had such an unbelievable influence over my life. And I always glad to hear that. And I always dread hearing why. It's always the same thing. The men say, I convinced them to stop using shaving cream. It's true, I think this is my intellectual legacy. I'm surprised the shaving cream industry hasn't put a hit on me yet. In all the articles I've ever written, that's the name of it. Another one is that people told me that I convinced them to start drinking Carlo Rossi wine. That's another one. Yeah. Oh, that's good. A little bit of a pause there. So another one is that women come up to me and they say, thank you for convincing me to use trisodium phosphate in my laundry. So you see the kind of influence I had on the world. You know, these practical ways of hacking the system. It's worked for me. So it turns out I'm actually more or less from Texas. But by accident of history, my parents were languishing in Northern California and happened to bear me. You know, so I was born in Fresno, which is a little bit embarrassing, so don't tell me about that. Because, as a matter of fact, you can't believe it, but my great-great-great-grandfather lived, settled in Alpine, Texas in 1832. Alpine, you know? So, I think about this all the time because, wow, right? 1830s, the age of laissez-faire. I mean, there wasn't government, but you didn't sort of notice it, you know? It didn't have any real impact on your life. And I don't entirely understand what happened, but, or maybe I do. But his father was a Congregationalist minister in Boston, which must have been, as it is today, the worst city on the planet. And a Congregationalist minister of all things. So in those days, the states used to send around advertisements around the country. Move here. Here you'll find freedom. Here you'll find riches. Here you'll find wealth. All you need to do is get in a covered wagon and come here. You'll find everything you ever dreamed of. Which of course they knew, as we all know about advertisements. It's not true. But he decided to take the risk in any case. And Texas was an unsettled land of great danger and no certainty whatsoever. But he would leave behind what he must have hated, which was a life ecstatic, deadly, doctrine, and stasis, and predictability. And hierarchy. He knew what his life was going to be like in Boston, and he wanted something else. He wanted adventure. He wanted uncertainty. He wanted the unknown. He wanted a chance to make a life for himself. And so one day, he got a flyer about moving to Texas. And he said to his father and mother, goodbye. And he got on the stagecoach. And he rode, and he rode. And in those days, it must have taken a long time. And he stopped by Nashville, where inevitably, as we all do in Nashville, he fell in love. And he found a wife. And he moved somebody gets mad at you and get in an argument, they say, get the fuck out of my car. And they drop you off. You will die. You will definitely die. This is the place where they don't worry about escape prisoners, because they don't. No question. But it's a free country. Then, as an what? Well, you know, if you know this. It's like when you're there, you think, what kind of weird system do we have where we pretend as if this government in some foreign land of Washington, D.C. presumes to rule this country? It can't possibly happen. These are free people. They do what they want. This is agorism in real life. Like, nobody there acknowledges any power outside themselves whatsoever. And this is my family. 1832, what a year. He joined the Texas Rangers, which is something like a prestige thing in Texas, not to me. I mean, there must have been some vagabond, you know, radicals who said, I won't have anything to do with the Texas Rangers, I just want to go on my own. Unfortunately, that wasn't my great-great-grandfather. But they settled the area, and they became quicksilver miners, and his son, he went off on his own way too, and he became a blacksmith. By the way, the blacksmith shop is still there, actually. Stroud's blacksmith shop is still there. And blacksmiths in those days were very interesting because they had the most important thing. They had the property, they had the tools. So he made tools in his blacksmith shop. And then a war broke out. And it was the war between the states, except for something strange happened. There wasn't any other state-defined, really, so we just fought the Indians. For some reason, somebody can easily explain this to me, but so he was recruited, and this will give you the chills. He was recruited to be the medic for his unit, a medical doctor, you know? And why? Because he had blacksmithing tools, that's why. Which, right? I think medicine those days really amounted to just hacking off limbs. That was pretty much what he did. Except this is a compassionate man. And he invented something he called Stroud's liniment. The liniment, I think he poured it on wounds. You could drink it. You could pour it on wounds. I think that's basically it. Pour it on wounds, you drink it. And he got after the war, he got a patent, you know. And I once asked my grandmother, I said, what the hell is in Strasbourg actually? And she just said, sort of strangely with a sense of like dread, you don't really want to know. I said, oh, I still kind of want to know, but. You know, that's our history. It's the history of the state, it's my history. And I think back to the decisions they made. He made on his own, and yet it affects me as I stand here, that I can call this my home because of some decision made 108 years ago. A decision that was insane. It was crazy. We ventured out into the unknown to do something I'm sure his parents did not approve of. But he did it anyway because he believed in something he had not experienced yet. He had hope in the future, and that future eventually came. And eventually died. I think he had a tough life. I think he had a terrible life. Or maybe he didn't. Maybe he thought he was happy because he was free. I don't know. But he was free. And he did something wonderful and radical. And eventually, Texas was more or less settled, except for, of course, Alpine. So, visionaries, stepping out, doing crazy things. Do we know about that? I mean, surely. I think we do. All of us. Each of you, in your own way, has done something crazy. You stepped out. You broke from the pack. You left what was expected of you to follow some dream that you hoped would come along at some point. In any case, you had to go your own way. All of us did at some point in our life. We took that brave path. We departed from our peers because we could see something in our minds that hadn't been realized yet. We imagined a better life. You have all done this. That's why you're here. But so many before us have done this too. I think back. I was thinking about when we want to go back to. We want to go back to 1971, the foundation, the founding of the Libertarian Party. Let's go back a little bit earlier. Let's go back to 1946. This, my friends, was a very dark world. Everybody agreed that the state ruled all, everywhere. Call the system what you wanted, socialism, fascism, communism, Russia, Italy, Germany, United States, UK, all over the world, democracy, freedom, individualism, it was dead. Everything would be determined by the people at the top, and let's not kid ourselves. As much as, we look down on them, we had very much the same system that they did. It was an authoritarian, top-down system. The prevailing ethos in the time, 1946, was that if we give enough power to the smartest people in the world and endow them with massive resources, they could make a better place than letting people have power themselves. That was the prevailing ethos, and everybody believed it. And the world was a dark place. If you were alive in World War II, you were drafted, or you were at home, on the home front, and obeying price controls, and getting allocations of goods and services according to what our masters gave us, knowing only what they told us to know, and having no means of access and communication to the rest of the world. We lived in a terrible despotism, a terrible time. A terrible time to be alive. A time without hope. A time that was thoroughly dark. Why would anybody believe there could be a future for human liberty as it was once known, as my great-great-grandfather knew it? It was dead and gone. And everybody believed, all the top academics in the whole world, and all the world's smartest people believed that it was an idea that was foolish and stupid. And only a handful of people at the time decided that this was incorrect, and they stepped out and did something wonderful. They founded institutions, they wrote books, they fought for what was true. And I think about people like Ayn Rand, who wrote a beautiful book, The Fountainhead. I think about my mentor, Libertarian, whom I never knew, but I've read him enough to feel as if he's a friend, who wrote in 1944 his brilliant work on competent government, which is still my Bible in some ways. And I think about Leonard Reed, a very interesting man, a grocer in Michigan, who became the head of the Chamber of Commerce in Los Angeles in 1946, founded the Foundation for Economic Education, whom I'm presently thrilled to work for. And he founded this institution in 1946 because he believed in the power of an idea that the world could only be saved by human liberty, that liberty itself is the greatest idea ever imagined in the human mind. But it was going away. So he founded an institution the foundation of economic education, who served as a kind of lighthouse for this idea, and found himself under enormous suddenly pressure to use this institution to do good works. Ludwig von Mises came over here as a refugee in 1940. He found himself in a position in 1946 of being in a position of sponsoring this man and letting him lecture. And then his book came out in 1949. The book was Human Action. The publisher didn't want to publish it, so the fee was there to buy the first print run, you know? And it became a bestseller because it was kickstarted by this institution, which was funded by people who made grave sacrifices. All of these people did. They made grave sacrifices because they believed in something that was unseen, because they had faith in the future, because they had hope that something could happen that wasn't currently happening, but if they fought and believed in it, that it could happen. And it did happen. And let us not forget the sacrifices that they made for us. We all sit in this room feeling pretty awesome, because we all have a sense that history is moving our way, and it is. We feel good about that. But let us not forget the people who came before, who suffered so much, and that died without ever seeing their dreams realized. And why did they do it? Because they had a passion. Because there was something in them that told them that this was the right thing to do. Just as this was something to you that tells you it's the right thing to do. Because you have faith. And we all stand in some ways as their successors. The proteges of these people, they gave this world to us. And let's think about our contemporary heroes. Let's think about Ron Paul, my dear friend. He himself benefited very deeply from his education. He got the tutelage of Hans Hempels, who himself was a colleague and student of Ludwig Mises, who 10 years before he came to the US was a Jew living in Vienna, destined to be put on a cattle car to a concentration camp, headed for a gas chamber most likely, but got out just in time. Do you see how fragile that is? I mean, it could have been taken away from us like that in an instant. The world might have stayed permanently dark, were it not for a handful of people who stepped up, who saw an opportunity, who left the prevailing status quo, departed, they claimed their independence as individuals, and said, I believe I can make a difference in this world. I matter, and my life matters if I do this on my own. Right now, even if everybody makes fun of me, my family, my social group, my peers, the government, everybody's against me, I'm going to do it anyway. And they did. They did this. And we, today, are so fortunate because we benefit. You know what's great, my friends, about this? I think about this all the time. We're so fortunate. We are so fortunate. We are living in a time in which we can see liberty blooming, blossoming, beautiful, all over the world. We have the tools, the communication systems. I mean, what we just did a little bit ago by pressing a couple of buttons and reaching, you know, tens of thousands of people, probably, potentially millions, potentially billions of people with the push of a button. Unthinkable power to have influence on this world. We're surrounded by points of light, by evidence that we have a chance, that liberty can make a difference in the world. Why do we despair? We don't. And we won't, will we? We will always have hope. Because if they can have hope, 1946, 1832, suit in 2016, with all the opportunities we have. There's no excuse for despair. Let me take you back to another time. 1971, the foundation of the Libertarian Party. Interesting times. There was a handful of people who believed that liberty was possible. I don't know what was going on. There were traffic riots. There was a lot of discontent in the air with the Vietnam War. There was Woodstock. Do you ever think about Woodstock? I used to think it was just like this weird hippie convention. It must have been actually something different. I think about this now. Julie's a fan of Taylor Swift. Right? Right. So, and you didn't go to the concert I went to, but you've been to a concert, right? Right. And what happens at Taylor Swift concert? You feel a sense of community with everybody, right? And you're like, oh my God, we all love Taylor Swift, right? And I know this happened to me. More so than Justin Bieber concert for me, but. Do you think about Woodstock sometimes? Have you ever thought about this? I mean, right. I mean, I used to think of this as a bunch of hippies in love, you know, who cares about other people. Right. I mean, but no, it's wrong. I mean, because look, this is a time in which the whole generation would be told, be loyal to the nation state. Your community is the state. Your community is the politicians. We will make your community for you. Everything you have in common, everything that matters in your life, will tell you what that is. Elect us, and we'll assign our, you know, we'll tell you what to do, we'll manage your lives, and we'll assign Walter Cronkite to interpret the world for you. And, or whoever was the guy back then. So then they went to Woodstock and they said, look at this. I feel actually more connection with these people around me in this concert center than I do with the elites in Washington. And it's also like a revolutionary realization, I think, when you suddenly discover your peeps, you know? Maybe you feel that the Libertarian Party, I don't know, but a sudden sense of detachment from the political elites, and you realize, I'm capable of finding people whom I love, with whom I share something really important and profound, and it matters more to me than what the nation state is telling me. And so your mind begins to detach itself from this artificial thing called the national state. It begins to attach itself to something else, to something that animates your soul and heart and really means something. So you know what I mean about your spirit. Right? But it must have been that way at Woodstock, right? I sometimes wonder, was that the beginning of the end? Was Woodstock the beginning of the end? I mean, you know, millions of people there suddenly realizing, having this realization that they didn't have to be, that their primary loyalties didn't have to be to the nation state, that we as a people have the capability of forming our own kind of communities, and that therein, where we find the thing that makes our hearts come alive, that's our real home. These are our real people. This is our real nation, you know? So maybe that was the end of the nation state. I don't know, but a lot of things happened in the 60s to begin to break down the civic culture. Anyway, a handful of people said, you know what? The Republicans and Democrats are going to do it for us. Let's found a new party, the Libertarian Party. Those were my friends, that was 45 years ago, right? And Murray Rothbard was written, they wrote a letter. In those days, people used to do the strangest thing. They would write letters to each other. Dark ages. And Murray wrote back a letter and said, you know, I'm really against this because I don't think the Empire is a thing because I'm afraid that if we don't win elections, that people are going to conclude that libertarianism is not very popular and it's unsuccessful. And I'm afraid that if we found the Libertarian Party, it's just going to be kind of this periodic affirmation that liberty doesn't matter. So I think it's going to be bad for PR. And then somebody else wrote in a letter, he said, you know, Americans are funny people. They can only get interested in big ideas in the course of elections. And if libertarians stay permanently out of the cycle of the American habit of only thinking about big ideas, you know, every 4 years, but we stay permanently out of that. Nobody's ever going to care about the right as a rule. And he thought about it. He said, you know, this is the point. I'm going to put myself into it. So he did it. He became a Libertarian Party member and an enthusiast. In fact, probably too much of an enthusiast, actually. He dedicated a large part of his 1970s life to factional fight with the LP. But it was an amazing time. 2 years later, he came out with a wonderful book, Foreign New Liberty. Has anybody read this book, Foreign New Liberty? So if you, it's worth visiting, actually, and reading. I suggest to you the first and last chapters. The first chapter is a beautiful humanitarian vision about what liberty means to the world. And it inspires me. I reread it all the time. And the last chapter is about why it is really our time. And you know what, in fact, he really highlighted in the last chapter? This is 1973. He talked about Watergate. I have a vague memory of Watergate. It's incredible that I have a vague memory of the hearings. So sitting around my grandmother's house listening to the Watergate hearings, where everybody was counting on the president, where everybody was convinced that the US president, all people engaged in a vast cover up and conspiracy. And Murray said in Foreign New Liberty, he said, you know what? As implausible as this seems, this is the beginning of the end. The beginning of the end of the nation state. There will be no future for the nation state after this, because the nation state depends fundamentally on an exalted presence. Without a godlike figure at the top of this ghastly, artificial, wicked system that's been erected in the course of the 20th century, it will gradually erode, and people's confidence in the system will begin to evaporate. So we must seize on this moment and explain the truth of human liberty to the human population. Watergate, the beginning of the end, Herbert Murray. It took longer than he imagined. He died in 1995, when he was a dear friend of mine, God bless his soul. I wish you were around today. I wish you could be around to see what's happening to our political system. Do you look at it as a calamity? Or a wonderful, wonderful, joyful affirmation of everything you do. These people have become ridiculous in the eyes of vast numbers. The New York Times ran an article about a month ago. They said, you know, there's some very strange things going around the polls. It's not unusual to have one candidate from one party being tremendously unpopular. But ever since our polling back in 1998, when that happened, there's always been the other leading contender for the other party who wasn't unpopular. This year, we face a very dangerous situation where the candidates for the top two parties in this country are mysteriously loathed by masses of people. And this is a very troubling situation. They're very worried about this. What does it pretend? I can tell you what it pretends. It pretends the continued decline and fall of the thing we hate, which is the central state as the manager of our lives. It's all based on a lie, and it's all coming apart. And I think it's coming apart now. Thank God for the Libertarian Party that it existed, that it was founded in 1971, and that it's here today. And we are being noticed. The New York Times again last week ran a huge feature on its front page about the Libertarian Party. Did you see it? I mean, this is like epic stuff with the establishment in April of an election year. Is running a major front page story on the Libertarian Party. Is this the thing? Is this our year? You know, Gary Johnson, of course, is featured very prominently in the story. And as I said, even Austin Peterson, you know, made the New York Times, which of course is the fulfillment of everything he ever went through. His dream has been achieved whether he wins or not. He's mentioned the New York Times. This guy is very smart. Watch him. So they're talking about us. Is this our year? Is this our year? I mean, I'm worried even to say that. And yet, my friends, it could be. This could be it. This could be our time. I don't know. But whether it is or not, here's the thing. I think this is a really good point. An idea is loose on the land. An idea is more dangerous, more devastating, more potentially earth-shattering than any weapon in the physical world. And that idea is that you should be at home. It's a nice idea. And it's revolutionary. And it could change everything. That's what the Libertarian Party means. As I was listening to the candidate debate, right? We all enjoyed that the other night, right? It was a wonderful debate. I mean, how interesting was it to hear fundamental issues and talk about like this? I told Gary, I said, you know, to run for the Libertarian Party president must be an odd thing. It's a little bit like campaigning to be the CEO of the company, but your one promise is to drive the stock price down to zero. It's a little bit counterintuitive in a way. So here's what matters. I felt this from all the candidates that were on stage. None of them really want to be our leaders. And thank goodness for that, right? We don't want that. We don't want a leader anymore. We've had a century of this shit. And we don't want it anymore. All we want is an idea. And that idea is the idea of human liberty. That's the idea of the change the world. Change the world starting about 500 years ago. And it continues to change lives. It builds the civilization we know and love. It's built everything beautiful. And the whole world, there's nothing that doesn't emanate from the idea of humanity. You understand simpleness. Potentially every human being on the planet. It's up to us as ambassadors of this idea to explain it to others. How does an idea work? It's a fascinating thing. An idea is different from anything in the physical world. An idea is malleable. It's portable. It's weightless. It's, in some sense, immutable. Contains magical properties. There's a reason why government censors, because they understand the danger of an idea on the loose. An idea can change the world, a simple idea. It sets off like something more powerful than the explosion. It changes the hearts and minds of men and women. And when that happens, there's no power. Stop it. All the governments in the world have never, really, ever been effective in crushing an idea. When the idea is unleashed, it's over. And we have the tools now. We do. Thank heavens we do. We do. The internet was invented in 1995. This is the beginning of the age of the new, or the web. The beginning of the age of life. And by the way, that was the year Murray Rothbard died. And I'm almost certain that God did this because he had some way to replace this man's influence in the world. So he invented the internet for us. We're using it. We all have the tools. We have the tools in our pockets. We have the tools. They're cheap, they're wonderful, they're available to us. We have the power, we have more power than each of us in this room than FDR ever had. Think about it, or Woodrow Wilson, or any other tyrant in history. You alone are more powerful than probably any head of state who's ever existed, just because you have access. All we really need is courage. Courage to step up. You have it because you're here tonight. Inspired among your fellows. Let me return back to my great, great, great grandfather. When he left his mother and father to move to Texas, I I'm not sure that he ever really believed he would ever see them again. How would he do such a thing? Why would you leave your family that way to undertake such a wild adventure as that? I think it's because he had a mind in his head. You know? And he couldn't shake it. So he decided to bear any cost, to undertake any work, to make every necessary sacrifice, to realize something beyond. To make his life truly matter. It's always easier to stay where you are. Stay in Boston. I don't know if you're gonna do that, but you could have done that. He was like a third generation, like his great-grandfather came over on the Mayflower. And I can't even imagine the oppressive world that lived there. It was just dreadful. Anyway, all he wanted was freedom. He wanted an adventure. He wanted something new, something fresh. So he left. He left his parents. He went to this foreign land of craziness and changed history for my family, changed history for me. Today, all of you are changing history. You're changing history for your fellows, for your friends, for your family. But not just for you. Everyone in this room, at some point. You're all immortals. We will not consider you. We have to ask what kind of world we want to live. Future generations will be freer, or will it be dark and oppressive? I really believe it's something else. Everything you see around you, everything began with an idea. But they're old ideas, and a lot of them are very bad. But the ideas you hold in your head, that's what will build the future. And if they're good ones, we can have a beautiful future. Together. Thank you, my friends, for joining me.